The John Lebang Show has been known to make people laugh, sing, think, scream, throw things in rage, and generally lose their minds. Listener discretion is advised.
And up next, we have a new monthly segment called Rock’n’Roll Unravelled with Derek Shelmerdine, author and good friend. Derek, how you doing?
I'm doing very well, John. It's great to be talking to you again, mate.
Thank you. Where are you joining us from today?
I'm in Spain at the moment, in Marbella. Very pleasant.
You wear me out hearing about how much you travel. You know, you make the Grateful Dead look like slackers.
I like to move around and try not to let people catch up with me.
So, you know, we have a lot to get to. Why don't we get started with The Who?
Okay, well, the idea is to look at what The Who were doing and other people back in the day, the 60s and 70s, and where we can actually see them now. And one of the first things that was interesting for The Who, back in 1964 on the 9th of April, they failed two auditions on the same day. First one was with the record label Fontana, but the guy, Chris Parmenter, didn't like the drummer. Good news for Keith Moon, because that meant that on this very day, 30th of April 1964, Keith Moon auditioned for The Who. What was a bit spooky was that great similarity between the Beatles and The Who's demise, because when the Beatles went for their first recording session, George Martin decided that Pete Best wasn't the drummer, and out he went, and in came Ringo Starr.
And it was good for us on both ends.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, The Who would not have been The Who without Keith Moon. I think he was a real part of their sound. But one of the things that we never really got to experience, back on 26th of April 1971, Pete Townshend, the guitarist, abandoned his Lifehouse project. This was a major rock opera, basically, to follow up on the Tommy rock opera. But it got abandoned. What it was the story of a sort of post-apocalyptic, polluted, mind-controlled world where the hero attempts to provide freedom through rock and roll. Sadly, the concert where it was all supposed to happen, the mind-controlled people and the people at the concert just simply vanished into thin air.
And that was never released?
It wasn't released at the time. What did get released, and what was salvaged from it, was The Who's next album. The one with Barbara O'Reilly, and that is one of their best albums. I mean, it was, they did some recordings. The idea was that it was going to be a movie with live concert footage, and they did record some concerts, and they did record some studio stuff as well with Al Cooper and Leslie West. So, I mean, there are recordings around. Of that, which is great. But you can actually see The Who on tour now, and if you're lucky enough to be in Canada and Australia, between USA rather, between the 13th of July and the 16th of August, you can find them dotted around.
Yeah, that's like their 50th anniversary or something like that tour?
That's right. And then in Vegas for six nights, so you combine a little bit of a flutter with a night out with The Who, which would be good. All these tour dates can be found on my webpage. So I'm not going to read them through. I mean, there are hundreds across all of these things. But that's good news for Who fans. Also good news for Beach Boys fans. Back in 1965, on the 9th of April, Bruce Johnson replaced Glen Campbell. And for anybody thinking, well, I didn't realize Glen Campbell was in the Beach Boys, he'd replaced Brian Wilson on tour when Brian famously had a nervous breakdown at the end of 1964. Now, Glen Campbell was always a temporary replacement because he went off to have his own career, and Bruce Johnson became a fully-fledged Beach Boy. The Beach Boys as well, on the 27th of April 1971, were on stage together with the Grateful Dead. Oh, that must have been a cool concert to have a look at. Because they actually duetted on the Okie from Muskogee, a sort of odd song for the Grateful Dead to be playing, and Chuck Berry's Johnny B. Good. It would have been a great show. I mean, they played a couple on their own, I Get Around and Good Vibrations. One of the good nights out at the Fillmore East. Now, what's great for Beach Boys fans is that there are two tours on the road most of this year. Mike Love and Bruce Johnson have licensed the name the Beach Boys, and they're touring as the Beach Boys. And you can catch them in America, UK, Ireland, Europe. And then the tour finishes off back in the USA up until the 9th of November. And also on tour till the 13th of October is Brian Wilson and Al Jardine. And they're doing the Pet Sounds 2017 World Tour. So if you're a Beach Boys fan, there's a lot of opportunity to catch these guys. I mean, Brian Wilson also does America, but he's also doing Denmark as well as Europe, Ireland, UK and Canada. So just about wherever you are, there's a good chance to catch your favorite Beach Boy in action.
And they've actually been going longer than the Rolling Stones, right? They're probably the longest standing act right now, the Beach Boys?
They certainly are. Yeah, they started a little bit earlier. I mean, they certainly have been one of the great stayers of the rock and roll world, I think, the Beach Boys. I mean, somebody else who's been going a long time as well is Bob Dylan. He, back in 1961, he just arrived in New York, and on the 11th of April, he played what was essentially his first major gig in Greenwich Village at Gaither's Folk City. And the band, who played, you know, as Bob Dylan's backing band quite a lot, it was an interesting day for them as well. They gave their first ever concert as the band in 1969 on the 17th of April. That's a bit deceptive because, I mean, they've been together a long time because they were Ronnie Hawkins' backing band, the Hawks, and they recorded with him, Mojo Man, back in 1962. So they've been around a long time. And they famously backed Bob Dylan on his 65-66 electric tour when he had some serious heckling at a concert in the UK.
Really? They didn't like him or something?
Oh, yeah, a lot of the folk purists. It was a time when Bob Dylan moved from being acoustic artist to electric artist. And a lot of the folk purists, both in America and Europe, took quite a dim view of this.
All they wanted to hear was, everybody must get stoned.
Yeah, exactly. But you can catch him now in the UK, USA and Canada. Up until the 27th of July, he's on the road again. So that's good news.
Does he have a new album or anything, or is he just touring?
No, he has, I can't remember the name of it, but he has just brought a new album out.
It's amazing these guys can still produce stuff.
Oh, it's absolutely unbelievable. And it's a great time for Deep Purple fans. I mean, they've got a lot of things going on. In 1966, 25th of April, Richard Blackmore was playing the band called Neil Christian, the Crusaders. And the thing about them was they had a string of really good guitarists. Jimmy Page, Albert Lee, Mick Abrahams went on to form Jethro Tull. But Deep Purple had their first ever gig on the 20th of April, 68. They were still called Roundabout then. The idea was that Chris Curtis, the Searchers drummer, he thought, well, let's have a band where we have a core of musicians and other high-profile musicians jump on and off the Roundabout. He didn't actually make the final cut, sadly, but the band itself morphed into Deep Purple. Richie Blackmore's final gig came on the 17th of April, 75, with Deep Purple. And he actually, happy birthday, Richie Blackmore, born on the 14th of April, 1945. And they're also on tour at the moment. And great news for Deep Purple fans is there are three ways you can see them. Deep Purple themselves are back. Ian Paice, Roger Glover and Ian Gillan from the sort of original Deep Purples, as it were. They're still there with a couple of guys called Steve Morse and Don Airey. But they're on tour across Europe, USA, Canada, Scandinavia and the UK through till the end of the year, 23rd of November. But Richie Blackmore's got his own tours going down. He's touring with Richie Blackmore's Rainbow, and he's got a very short half a dozen gigs in the UK, 17 to 28 of June. And he's also with his band Blackmore's Night, which is much more folky. He's playing some Europe gigs between the 30th of July and the 19th of August. So I think all in all, it's a good time for rock and roll fans.
It is. And I tell you, I would love to go see Richie Blackmore's Rainbow. And it's just too bad Ian Paice, John Lord, I'm sorry, isn't with us any longer because I'm sure he'd be out there with Deep Purple on their tour.
Oh, I'm sure he would. I mean, he was one of the founding members. He was the first guy that came on board with the roundabout concept, because Chris Curtis, the searchers were very successful in the British invasion back in 64 to 66. And he was he shared a flat with John Lord for a while.
He was an amazing keyboard player. Ian Gillan did a solo project with Tony Iommi right before John Lord died, and John Lord played on that. Ian Gillan can still sing, and he's got that voice that it's so unique. Just amazing that he still can hit the high notes and he's still strong. He's got to be 70 plus years old.
He's got to be the other side of 70. Which is amazing when you think, I mean, just about everybody we've talked about are at best in their late 60s, and a lot of these guys are well into their middle 70s. All this information is up on the website. That's rock and roll, www.rockandrollunraveled.com. And I'm very active on the Twittering and the Facebook stuff. So anybody who's into all this sort of stuff, I'm banging all this out on a daily basis and trying to be a little bit obscure and very much look into what the book's about, which is Rock and Roll Unravel. Let's have a look at the background to a lot of what's going on.
And are you having any appearances with your book signings coming up?
I had one a couple of weeks ago, and I've got a very major quiz. It's one of the biggest in the UK. Just about every professional quizzer off the UK TV is going to be there, and I'm doing a signing at that, so that should be fun. But what I'm doing, I've got a couple in the pipeline. I've just got to fix the and the dates up. I try to do one every 4 or 6 weeks.
It's great to have you on, Derek. We'll see you again next month, right?
Oh, yes, I really enjoyed it. Great chatting to you, mate.
That's Rock and Roll Unraveled with Derek Shelmerdine. We'll be right back, folks.